Especially on this day of Guru Purnima, it's my honor to present this lecture. And I'll start straight away. And this is the topic which I would be doing. MRI in the rectal cancer. And this is, although it's supposed to be primer, but I would like to take, I would take through the next 45, 50 minutes about entire present, about entire things which are relevant in MRI in rectal cancer. So I work in Singapore and this is place where I don't have anything to disclose. I hope I'm clear and audible as well as my screen is clear and you can see that. So colorectal cancers are quite common and they are second most common cause of cancer related deaths. And rectal cancers are the subset of this cancer which occur in terminal 15 centimeter of bowel, which is anything which is more than that or more proximal to that will be colon cancers. And the tumor, the way they behave, the treatment is different. So the rectal cancers are classified as generally adenocarcinomas, which occur in 15 centimeter, terminal 15 centimeter of bowel. So what's the role of imaging? We really don't diagnose the rectal cancers on imaging. So very few cases, maybe sometimes incidentally we diagnose and then it gets worked up. But the primary role of imaging in rectal cancer is treatment triage of proven rectal cancer. So that's the primary role. And of course, the other role will be a response to treatment after chemoradiotherapy. So these are the two roles which is which are in for the imaging. And why, how that imaging and why the MR came into so much importance is for this particular surgery. I will just go briefly through that before we go into the imaging. This is the landmark or the way the treatment of colorectal cancer was surgical option was total mesorectal excision. Prof. Bill from UK was the first one who did this. What is this total mesorectal excision? It is end block resection of the primary tumor along with mesorectum, along with those nodes and the whole thing along the plane called as mesorectal facial plane or circumferential resection margin. So this is how it is to be done in the past. Maybe the tumor was removed along with the node, but what Prof. Bill was done was this total mesorectal excision when the tumor was removed along with this plane of mesorectal fascia, so in toto. So that's how the, and what it did was it improved the, there was less local recurrence. And what is this plane? Circumferential resection margin is a more of a pathological and surgical term, whereas mesorectal fascia is what we see on the scan. This is a thin, maybe 1 to 2 millimeter thick line on, this is the T2-weighted coronal images. And you can see that there's tumor. And this is what is a, what is the circumferential resection margin or a mesorectal fascia, which goes down, fuses with internal sphincter and fascia of Denon-Willers. So what it did was, as I was telling, it reduced the local rate of local recurrence, but also reduced the lower rate of permanent colostomy without adding any increased risk of urinary incontinence or sexual dysfunction as it was feared earlier. So the most important thing in rectal cancer, or for that matter, any cancer when they operate, is the surgical resection with negative margin. That is, there is no tumor extension within 1 millimeter of the resected margin on histology. That's the only standard locally curative treatment of rectal cancer, and that's very important. That's what we try to achieve and aid the surgeons by helping them with imaging. What happens if there is a failure to attain negative margin? That often results into tumor recurrence. There is possibility of incurable disease, poor quality of life, and generally reduced disease-free survival. So generally, how a cancer begins, it begins as a dysplastic epithelium, and as it progresses deep down, into it goes deeper into the involving the different layers, and we'll go through that again and in detail. So first, before we go to MR, we should understand what is the T-staging of the, that's where it, that's what is important, and we should know this, and it's quite, I try to make it simple. So this is a schematic diagram or schematic cartoon where there is a lumen, that's the white, and the submucosa is the pink, and the blue is muscularis layer. And the first will be a T1 stage when the tumor is confined to the mucosa or submucosa. T2 is the stage when the tumor has gone beyond the submucosa into the muscularis layer, but not beyond it. T3 tumor is the one which has gone beyond the muscularis into the surrounding planes. There is no serosa in rectum, unlike in the colon. So it goes into the mesorectal plane or mesorectal fat. Whereas T4 tumor is when it involves the surrounding structures like urinary bladder, and depending on the patient, whether it's a male or female, prostate, uterus, and seminal vesicles. So the first is, why not ultrasound? Can ultrasound do a good job? It can, especially endorectal ultrasound is good to differentiate T1 from T2 tumors, the early, very early tumors. And it has similar accuracy in detecting, differentiating T2 and T3 tumors. And as the disease progresses at higher stages, MRI is preferred. Why MR is preferred over ultrasound is because of its limitations. Limitations of ultrasound, not only it is operator dependent, but it also has limitations. It's not comfortable. Sometimes it's very difficult to do in a large or high tumors. If there's obstructing mass, we can't really do. There's assessment of the mesorectal fascia and lymph nodes is not so good with ultrasound as you can do with MR. Then the question is, why not CT scan? Can CT scan do a good job in local staging of the rectal tumor? Generally not, because the CT lacks the soft tissue resolution or capacity to differentiate the different structures as the MR does. We can see the top two rows are CT scan, the axial and coronal. We can see there is a tumor. There is a subrectal contrast given in this case long time back. And we can see that this is a tumor, but we can differentiate if there is a muscular layer and if the sphincters are involved much better or on MRI rather than CT scan. The role of CT with especially the higher resolution or the newer multi-slice CT would be probably in a cases such as if the patient cannot get MR done for certain reasons, or if the patient has contraindications, or if the patient has locally invasive tumor, maybe we can stop with CT scan and start the treatment and then come back to MR later. So whereas the primary role of CT scan is to do the M staging or to the distant metastasis. Like in this case, there's rectosigmoid tumor, there's liver metastasis. That's where the CT scan we do for a distant metastasis. Whereas MR is for local staging. Again, why MRI matters most is for this reason, that the current AJCC guidelines and staging, they are good to assess prognosis and overall survival, but they have limited utility to determine which patients should get chemo radiotherapy. So there are certain factors which are there, which are not incorporated in AJCC with a very granular manner, like is these things like anatomic factors, like where is the tumor, it's a low rectal tumor, middle rectal tumor, upper rectal tumor, all the AJCC or T stages will give the same staging, location, anterior and posterior, it matters where, and its relation to CRM. Although the T3 stages, but the more differentiation can be done with MR rather than if we just rely on AJCC, then other couple of important things is extramural vascular invasion, we'll come to it, and the sphincter complex assessment is MR only does it, and it's not so much detail differentiation is there in the AJCC staging. So coming to the role of MR in rectal cancer, is the primary role of this imaging or MR is to assist in treatment, triage of histologically diagnosed tumors. So first the histological diagnosis is done and then MR is done. So what we do is basically to triage these patients, the patients who go for upfront surgery or those patients who can benefit from preoperative chemo radiotherapy and downstage the disease and then go for surgery. And in lower one-third rectal tumor, assessment of the sphincter complex can be done with MR alone. And the next the role would be a post chemo radiotherapy staging, assessing the treatment response is done with MR. And then there is a new things which is happening in the surveillance as some cases after chemo radiotherapy for some reasons, we'll come to it again, is they don't get operated or they choose to get followed up in wait and watch. In these cases, MR plays a very important role because that's the only way we can assess what is happening apart from endoscopy, as well as clinical examination, tumor markers. So these are the two guidelines. One is SGAR guidelines, and then is SAR guidelines from US. More or less, they are same. You can see some of the names also are overlapping. So these are the guidelines which are followed. Although the guidelines say something, there are a few things more which we'll try to discuss today. So there are technical issues we should be aware of, or we should be, before we do MR, is we should have a high field strength MR. High field means anything which is beyond 1.5 Tesla. Endorectal coil is rarely used, although it can probably differentiate between T1, T2 tumors better and may have good resolution of a layer, I mean, the walls of the rectum on MR, but it's not comfortable. And the newer coil surface coils are quite good and they can give all the information. Bowel preparation is generally not needed. Maybe certain institutions can do microenemas for the higher rectal tumors, upper rectal tumors. Same way, spasmolytics again is not necessary, but doing that is individual preference. And the next is filling of the rectal lumen with a gel or contrast material is again not routine. We'll come to it with some images. And another thing is intravenous contrast is routinely not recommended. As per the guidelines, routinely not recommended, but may be useful in restaging after chemo-RT, or sometimes with the new things like dynamic enhancement, certain institutions or some institutions do that, but again, is not part of the standard guidelines. So what we do is the money sequence, or the most important sequence, is high resolution, T2 weighted FSC, non-fat set, a small field of view. And first we do is, we do a sagittal images and see where the rectal tumor is there. And we do axial and coronal small FOV images along the length of, perpendicular and parallel to the tumor in axial and coronal pairs as per the tumor. And in cases of a low rectal tumors, or when there is sphincter involvement is suspected, we may have to do two sets of images. We may have to do a imaging along the anal canal, which is perpendicular as well as parallel to it, to assess the sphincters. So these are the basic or the most important sequences, but of course we do diffusion weighted images, a large field of view, T1 weighted images, and sagittal images. So that completes the whole set of imaging with MR. So coming to the rectal contrast, as I was telling, it's not routinely recommended, but sometimes it may help in a picking up small tumors. Like in this case, there's rectal contrast, which is typically, if it is given, it's around 60 milliliter of ultrasound gel, which is pushed into the rectum. And then you can see a tumor delineation can be better, but it has its own drawbacks. Like in this case, we can see that the images on the right side, the axial and coronal are taken with the rectal contrast. At this, maybe there is some mucin here. And when you give rectal contrast, although the images may look beautiful or they may look very pretty, but what happens is that the rectum gets distended, and especially in the lower rectal tumors or even in the mid rectal tumors, the mesorectal fascia or mesorectal fat gets compressed because there's no room for its expansion, and you may get a false higher T stage, and which is not really what the surgeons would see the rectum, which is empty on surgical table. So that's not really needed. So that's why a rectal contrast is not routinely recommended in MR. So we have done this 1.5 Tesla or 3 Tesla, both are comparable, and there is no significant differentiation whether a T2 or T3 tumors can be better seen with 3 Tesla or not. So, but sometimes 3 Tesla can have a higher diffusion, there can be artifacts, but generally 1.5 Tesla or 3 Tesla both are equally good. So now coming to what we are looking for imaging on MR is first location of the tumor, where the tumor is located in relation to the sphincters, in relation to the anal verge, we'll see that, and we'll look at mesorectal fascia and the sphincters. Then we look at the tumor size, the length of the tumor, extent of the extramural spread. Again, we'll go into the details of it. Look at the peritoneal reflection, look at the extramural vascular invasion, which is very critical. Look at the mucin content, because MR is something which is very good to look at the mucin content, because pathology biopsy wise can have errors due to sampling. We look at the lymph nodes, although we are not very good at assessing these lymph nodes. Of course, we look at the bones, rest of the organs, whichever is visible on MRI, just like any other radiology imaging. So localization of the tumor is to locate the tumor. How to categorize this tumor into a high rectal tumor, mid rectal tumor, or low rectal tumor is its distance from the anal verge. And it's when I mean by its distance means the lower most end of the tumor and to the anal verge. And we have to draw a line which is maybe curving, and then we measure this distance. You can do three straight lines and measure this distance, and then call it as a mid-rectal, high-rectal, or low-rectal tumors. So that's the first thing we do. And then we see the length of the tumor or the distance of the tumor. Of course, after measuring this, whether it's high, mid, or low, then we see how long is the tumor or what's the length of the tumor. So that's one thing. And then coming to the T staging. For before we go into T staging, what's important is to look for muscularis propria, which is appears as a hypointense thin line on T2 weighted images along the outer layer of the rectal wall. So it lies between hyperintense mesorectal fat and hyperintense mucosa and submucosa, because we don't do fat SAT. So the fat, mesorectal fat is hyperintense, and the mucosa and submucosa is also hyperintense. And so the tumor typically has intermediate signal intensity, whereas a mucinous tumor are generally bright. Again, we'll go into the details of that again. So how a rectum wall would look on a normal, it looks mucosa and submucosa are bright, and the dark line which you are seeing around is a muscularis. So that's what is important, and the integrity of which or the breach of which is what we are trying to look. So we saw the T1 tumor is the tumor which involves the mucosa and submucosa, whereas T2 tumor is the tumor which involves the muscularis but not goes beyond it. But can we differentiate these two on MR? That's not possible. Maybe with endorectal coil we can do, or maybe with endorectal ultrasound, but T1, T2 differentiation is not possible routinely with MR. And we can report this as T1, T2. It doesn't really matter much as far as the treatment is concerned, except when an endoanal excision is planned. In that cases, sometimes you may have to do detailed imaging. But suffice to say, on routine MR, T1, T2 tumors cannot be differentiated and can be reported as such. A small tumor, which is very difficult, this was rectal contrast was given because there was a histopathological diagnosis of rectal tumor before this imaging was done. The rectal contrast was given. Very difficult to see the image, but you can see there is a tumor which is intermediate signal intensity with a preserved T2 dark line. So this was a early rectal cancer along a dark muscularis layer. So again, that's a T2 tumor. Another case of T2 tumor, which we saw earlier, a polypoid tumor, and then the muscular layer is preserved. We should be wary of something going beyond. We'll come to it again. Sometimes some of the longitudinal muscle layer, some of the vessel channel in desmoplastic reaction can appear as some linear things going out. So next is what happens when the T2 or the muscularis layer is breached. Then the tumor is staged as T3 because the mesorectal fat is invaded by the tumor. So just stranding in the mesorectum fat is not T3 tumor. And we should be very, or we should be, when we see a speculation in the mesorectal fat, we try to differentiate whether it's a benign desmoplastic reaction, which is seen as a low signal intensity on T2 weighted images, and they are generally linear, then it's still a T2 tumor, whereas tumor itself has an intermediate signal intensity and is typically nodular or tumor-like. So then it becomes early T3 tumor. But having said that, sometimes it can be difficult, and sometimes it may not matter in surgically, because both can be excised easily by the surgeon. So early T3 to differentiate from T2 can be difficult. So then comes, how do we differentiate these T3 tumors in a different granular fashion? How their classification is done? Again, it is how deep the tumor extends beyond the muscularis layer. So this extramural depth of invasion refers to the extension of the tumor beyond the muscularis propria and is a prognostic factor. So we'll go to this different stages. So T3 tumor, which is nothing but which has gone beyond the muscularis layer. And if it's less than 1 millimeter beyond the muscularis, so it's a T3A, whereas T3AB is 1 to 5 millimeter, T3C is 5 to 15 millimeter, whereas T3D is, which is beyond 15 millimeter. As we can think that something which is C or D has a bad prognosis, or this is a bad tumor compared to T3A and B. And the one differentiating or one cutoff by many many of the studies or many of the trials which do is 5 millimeter. Anything which is beyond 5 millimeter, most of the times patient may go for chemoradiotherapy. But again, that has to be discussed in the tumor board and decided with the surgeons. And sometimes, who knows, we can get operate these patients. So assessment of the T3 tumor is a few things we should be aware of before we do is, for ulcerated tumors, the growth occurs at the base of ulcer rather than edges. So we should know that. And we see that if it's ulcerated tumor, then try to see the at the base of the ulcer and try to see where the tumor is going. Assess in all the three planes to avoid partial volume averaging, just like any other case. I mean, anywhere in radiology, don't just rely on one plane. Buckling at the base of the polypoid tumor and vessels going through may appear as T3, but it not. It's not just, it's just vessel. And sometimes longitudinal muscle fibers can give appearance of something projecting beyond the rectal wall, which is not a T3 tumor. So we can't really do actual images along this. If this tumor is curving, we can't really do so. We should be wary, or we should be worried of, I mean, we should be aware of the tumor, which is has a very curving configuration. So not to make the diagnosis of extramural, going beyond the rectal wall or mesorectal facial invasion, just on one image, just like in this case, at this level, if you look, there is not much invasion. So we should look at the sagittal, coronal, as well as axial images. So I was talking about the base of polyp. So this is a case which I think we saw a few months back. This is a polypoid tumor. You can see that the base of the polyp, we can see there are vessels going. So this is not a T3 tumor. This is a polypoid base. So these are linear darks. They are not really looking like tumor. Ulcerated tumor, you can see this is ulcerated tumor. The tumor is quite big. But if you see, when you see ulcerated tumor, when you see ulcers, try to look at the base of the ulcer, because that's where the growth or the growth beyond the muscularis is more likely to occur. And other pitfalls to avoid is, don't make the patient to ward before the patient is on the MR, because if there's distended bladder, you can imagine that it can compress, and we shouldn't really have a over distended urinary bladder, and we might have to repeat the examination. Generally, empty bladder or maybe slightly full bladder would be enough. Then how to assess the invasion of mesorectal fascia is, before we do that, we should know what's the relationship of the peritoneal lining with rectum. In the upper rectum, what happens is the peritoneal lining is covering most of the anterior and lateral part of the rectum, whereas in the middle rectum, it is mostly anterior, whereas the lower rectum is non-peritonealized, where the mesorectal fascia is covering, it's there all around, and that's where we check. And when you are checking the when you're looking at this shortest distance, it should be from the mesorectal fascia, not the peritoneal, the peritonealized area. So the involvement of the circumferential resection margin or the mesorectal fascia is important, because there is 5-year survival is 20% worse in these cases compared to when it is not. So negative CRM involvement is more than 2 millimeter away from the tumor or node is away from it, or positive is less than 1 millimeter. And threatened, we call it when it is 1 to 2 millimeter from the mesorectal fascia. Although any of the following is used, either tumor, perirectal nodes, or any deposits of tumor stranding, but most in the practice or most important thing is the anything which is tumor. Rest other things you can discuss in the tumor board and then decide whether surgeons are comfortable in operating. And especially because metastatic lymph nodes are solely accounting for CRM involvement is very rare on pathology. So that's why predicting CRM positivity on MR based on just on the nodes should be avoided or discussed in the tumor board rather than giving straight away that it is involved. Another entity or another concept of this tumor deposit is quite controversial. As per AJCC guide or the AJCC definition, a tumor deposit is a nodule in the mesorectum with no nodal, vascular, lymphatic, or neural tissue on the pathology. So I think we can all guess that it's so difficult on MR to see which is tumor deposit and which is a node. So that's quite difficult, but generally it is proven on pathology is sometimes something which is going along the vessel, which is involved, then tumor deposits are generally along with the venous invasion. So early T3 tumors appear as a thin black lines. This could be even desmoplastic reaction or a small tumors. We can, since we don't really see black lines, some intermediate signal, so T3A or B tumor. And it, there can be T3AB tumor along with the inflammation or desmoplastic reaction. And but what is important is when we see obvious tumor which is going beyond the rectal wall and invading the mesorectal fascia. So that's obviously 3,3-D tumor because it's more than 15 millimeter. And more important, rather than 3,3-D, is it is involving the mesorectal fascia. So that's what is these patients will not go for upfront surgery. And we should also look for these tumors which have gone beyond, but also since it's radiology, we always look at all the corners. So there is a focal lesion in the femoral head. So that's a top stage of the disease. So there is a metastasis in the femoral head on the right. This is something very peculiar and not much literature is available, but we have seen few cases is when the tumor intercepts. So when there is tumor intercept, this is a CT scan on the bottom left, and these are the axial and coronal T2 weighted images. We can see there is a tumor which is intercepting from back. I mean, this is coming forward. And especially in these cases, what I was talking to surgeon is these patients are generally have low risk of CRM involvement because there is the tumor is free enough to travel through the mesorectum fat and intercept. And when the surgeons operate, they operate in toto. They don't try to reduce it on the table. So it generally has a it's less chances of involvement of the CRM in these cases. So after looking at T1, T2, and T3, then we come to the more higher stage of the tumor, that's a T4 staging. So T4A staging is one which involves the visceral peritoneum, whereas T4B is the involvement or the invasion of the adjacent organs. So before we go to the peritoneal involvement, because it's a T4A tumor, we have to identify the peritoneal reflection on MR. Generally, it can be difficult in certain cases, but generally around 70-80% of the times, we can pick this or we can see that very well. And we look at the axial as well as sagittal images, and sagittal images generally above the tip of seminal vesicles in men, and at uterocervical angle in the woman, we see the thin line, which is a peritoneum on sagittal images. And if there is a visceral peritoneal involvement, it is staged as T4A. When you mean by involvement, it's just the tumor is not going above the lining of the peritoneum, but it is invading into the peritoneum because there is increased risk of pelvic recurrence as malignant cells may be shed into peritoneum in these cases. So that's why it is T4A tumor. So T4A tumor has to invade through the visceral peritoneum rather than just traverse across the peritoneum. And abutment of the peritoneal reflection itself is not an invasion. If the tumor lies at the peritoneal reflection and without invading the peritoneum, it's not T4A tumor. But it can be difficult in mucinous tumor because it's again a high T2 bright, and the T2 bright fat in the mesorectum can be difficult, but that's one challenge we should be aware of. So how do we identify peritoneal lining? Is we can see there is thin line here, which is peritoneal lining. In this case, the tumor is going above. Probably the tumor is not invading into the peritoneum, but like in this case, we can see this is the on the coronal images, you can see the tumor is clearly invading in the visceral peritoneum. And like in this case, you can see that on the left, on the right, it is not. It looks like a seagull on the actual images. On the right, it does not look invaded, but on the left, you can see that this tumor signal and thickening of the peritoneum. So these are two different cases. So this is T4A tumor. Next, coming to T4B tumor is invasion of the adjacent organs or structures. Just like any other place in radiology, any other tumors, there is preserved fat plane between the tumor and the adjacent organs. There is no invasion. Possible invasion is if there's obscured fat plane, but no abnormal signal. When definite invasion is when there is not only obscured fat plane, but the abnormal signal is seen in the organ. And we should also give in the report distance from the lateral pelvic wall, adherence to the presacral fascia, contiguity with the penile bulb, because sometimes when there's pelvic excentration is planned or is a morbid surgery is planned, then in those cases, these things are also matters. So we should be reporting them. This is a case of probably a mucinous tumor. You can see this is the bladder, which is invaded, and this is the rectum, all the way huge mass, which is going to the bladder. Another case, couple of cases of bladder involvement. So you can see that it is invading into the bladder. So this is a fissula. You can see there is thin or a T2 track, T2 bright track, which is going from the rectal tumor into the bladder. So fissula to the bladder. Involvement of the prostate here. seminal vesicles, a couple of cases on the right. On this side, there's another case, which is we see dark signal here. Another case, which is you can see there is a clear thing, something which is going beyond the tumor, invading into the right seminal vesicle. And involvement of the uterus. I think, again, this is a case very polypoid, very, I think, mucinous component, and then it is invading into the uterine fundus here. And pelvic sidewall deposit, I was telling, when you were planning a excentration like surgeries, the pelvic sidewall deposit, or even otherwise also, we should be looking for these generally around the obturator internus muscle. So we should be reporting them and look for them. And tumor perforation and abscess is very important. It's even if the tumor stage is, if there's perforated tumor and non-perforated tumor, and the tumor definitely with perforation has a bad biology or bad prognosis, worse prognosis as compared to the without perforation. You can see there is tumor which is perforated, there's CT scan MR, another case of MR, we can see the tumor which has perforated and there is a small abscess. So next, coming to generally tumor, the tumors are adenocarcinomas, but sometimes these are apart from the routine adenocarcinomas, the other tumors are mucinous tumor. And when we call them mucinous tumors, it's more than 50% of the tumor volume, which contains extracellular mucin. Why they are important is because there are more chances of metastasis, and generally they are higher stage at diagnosis and generally has poor prognosis. And mucinous tumor, although is a histological diagnosis, but it can have sampling issue, and that's why the role of MR is important, because accuracy of MR in detecting this mucinous histology component in rectal cancer is better than even superior even to biopsy. So how do these tumors look? They look like T2 hyperintense on MR. And T1 weighted images are useful because when they are T2 hyperintense, it's very difficult to differentiate from the mesorectal fat. So that's where the T1 weighted images are useful. They're generally less cellular, so they're higher ADC, so they're not diffusion restricting. And as I was telling you earlier, it's challenging to assess the peritoneal involvement in these cases because extracellular mucin and mesorectal fat both are T2 hyperintense. And just when it is abutting the peritoneum, we can give it as a peritoneal involvement in these cases and can be upstaged as T4A tumors. So we can see this is a mucinous tumor in the rectum and generally very T2 bright. Another case, you can see that on the seat, on this is on MR, and this is CT scan. CT scan looks very hypodense. T2 again bright. The T2, the nodes also can be very bright on MR and hypodense on CT. This can be difficult sometimes. So sometimes having a T2 fat sat or a T1 weighted images are useful. So they are not diffusion restricting. So these are special. These are important tumors we should be aware of. And this is tumor, mucinous tumor, which has intersuscepted, and you can see that there is a hypodense tumor on CT scan, and which is T2 hyperintense, and vessels which are, you can see that because it is intersuscepting. So we should be aware of mucinous tumor, and this is, it can look very cystic almost sometimes, very T2 bright. It's almost in the anal canal here. This is mucinous tumor, but since it's not cyst because it's enhancing. And it has some calcifications and it's not bright on PET images. So it may not be bright on PET. So PET can be falsely negative due to low glycolytic metabolism. And sometimes PET MR may be useful in these cases because the mucinous component, this is from the, this image particularly is from the article, not mine. And the rest, so this PET MR may be useful in these cases. Next, coming to one specific tumor location, which is very critical or very important, is low rectum, which also includes anal canal. And when anal canal is included, it means adenocarcinoma of the anal canal, not squamous cell carcinoma, because that's a totally different entity. And that's not what we are talking today. The lower rectal tumors are important because they have worse prognosis. Few reasons. One is thinner mesorectum and sphincter complex. So it's difficult to operate. And very important to important information, what is needed is distance from the inferior border of the tumor to the top border of the anal sphincter. Because if we want to plan a sphincter preservation surgery, this information is critical. So as I was telling, it should be differentiated from squamous cell carcinoma. That's only from histopaths. So they are different and their whole biology is different. And only from, and it's important because the whole staging behavior, everything changes with the squamous cell carcinoma. So how the lower rectal tumors are evaluated is not really in a routine T stages what we saw, but maybe as a stage when internal sphincter is something which is important, which can be taken as mesorectal fascia equivalent. Is partial or full thickness involvement of the musculoscapular or internal sphincter is stage one or two. Extension into the intersphincteric plane is stage three, whereas which is gone beyond into the external sphincter and other muscles will be stage four. So if tumor is close to the anorectal ring on the other rectal cancers, use Levetiracetam instead of mesorectal fascia for as equivalent of CRM. So this is a low rectal tumor extending to the anal canal. We can see on the right, internal sphincter as well as external sphincter is involved. On the left, there is internal sphincter is involved, but it is going and maybe it abutting or involving the external sphincter, not beyond it. Sometimes if there is, it can perforate and can have abscesses. Like in this case, like in this, no, there is, it can involve the sphincters. I'll show you the cases of abscesses. There is a, this involvement of the sphincter. And then it can go, it can have a, like in this case, probably is a mucinous cancer. It can invade the pelvic side wall. And as I was telling, it can perforate. So that's on a T2, it sometimes can be difficult, but post contrast images, you can see there is a abscesses in the ischioanal and ischiorectal fossa. So that was of the low rectal tumor. The next, another important thing which MR does play a very important role is to looking for extramural vascular invasion. So what is this? Is this is nothing but extension of the rectal tumor into the veins beyond the musculoscapular. It is not only going into the beyond in the adjacent fat planes, but it is going into the veins. Why is it important? Because it's an independent prognostic indicator associated with higher incidence of metastasis and local recurrence. Poorer response to the post preoperative chemoradiotherapy, and overall the survival rate is less. The more it, and it is, I was telling, the most frequent and independent risk of synchronous metastasis is extramural vascular invasion with MR, whereas metachronous higher incidence of metastasis is by extramural vascular invasion. It has higher chance of synchronous metastasis. As I was talking about, the metachronous metastasis is higher with mucinous cancers. So how do we assess this? Is presence of the tumor signal intensity the vessel? So it expands, it can expand the vessel, it can direct this, it can, this tumor can spread through it beyond the vessel wall also. So expanded vessel, nodular vessel, abnormal signal intensity, all are features of extramural venous invasion. So there is grading of it also. I think that's just for the whether there is a perivenular fat is involved, whether there are adjacent lymph nodes, either obstruction, thrombus, all these things that's used to grade this extramural venous invasion. Just a couple of cases, we can see that there is something tubular with a tumor signal which is going beyond the mesorectum. So this is extramural vascular invasion. It can be either nodular or skip. Extramural EMVI, and another case which is continuous and it can have expanded vessels, abnormal signal, irregular, which is going beyond. So it looks, this is quite clear. So it is supposed to, MR is supposed to play a very important role, better than even on histopath in certain cases. So, but there are interpretive challenges. Again, I was with similar, like at the base of polyp, if the, any vessel going to the tumor should not be mistaken for extramural vascular invasion because they are the normal vessels which go to the polyps. After talking about the tumor itself, then coming, let's talk about the node, which can be difficult. The regional nodes which account for end stage are mesorectal nodes, then superior, middle, and inferior rectal nodes, and sigmoid, mesenteric. All these nodes are regional nodes as per the end stages, whereas any other nodes are considered as metastasis. So currently what we use is size, short axis, and then their shape and morphological criteria. They have their variable sensitivities and specificities, and it can be difficult, although there are various criteria which are suggested, but it can be difficult. And it is sometimes called as nodal staging accuracy is as accurate as flipping a coin. So when it is just a 50%, it's probably a flipping a coin. So what are these criteria are, first is short axis diameter, and then there are morphologic criteria. There are three morphologic criteria: round shape, irregular border or contour, heterogeneous signal. And if it's more, a short axis is more than 9 millimeter, we should suspect it is, call it as suspicious nodes. If it is 5 to 8 millimeter, we should have two or more these morphologic criteria is associated or less than 5 millimeter, then all the three are present. Even if it's less than 5 millimeter, we can call these are suspicious nodes. But nodal assessment is always difficult sometimes on MR, and the nodes which are called as pathologic have turned out to be many times benign, and sometimes the nodes which are less than 5 millimeter, around 20-30% of the times they can be metastatic. So we can see there is abnormal signal, heterogeneous signal, irregular bond contour, irregular boundary. So you can see this is probably a normal signal from the gland, and then this is tumor signal, irregular border. So all these factors we should take into account, but sometimes again, it can be difficult. Diffusion weighted images has again low to moderate sensitivity. It is not included in any guidelines, but sometimes diffusion weighted images help to pick up these nodes, and then we can look at them with T2 weighted images to look for if there are any abnormal things are there. And then there are various new things like USPIO, iron-based nanoparticles, which are supposed to, but again, they are all mostly as research, but not in a common setting. So diffusion-weighted images can pick up the nodes, but not always they will be pathological. But diffusion-weighted is also useful to pick up the tumor, but again, that's not a part of the standard guidelines, but they will be bright except mucinous tumor. Another case, and although the diffusion, it was very bright, this node, but it was very small and hardly any abnormal signal, and this was benign on pathology or histologically benign. What's the role of PET scan in nodal staging? It is highly specific for the identification of the malignant node, but the sensitivity is quite low because its inability to accurately localize the involved node, because the tumor itself is so bright, and then there's tumor nodes are surrounding it, it can be difficult to pick up. But FDG PET is more suitable for the assessment of the extramucorectal nodes because there is not higher uptake of the tumor surrounding it. So it can pick up extramucorectal node much better. So next, coming to what are the surgical options which are available. So briefly talking about surgery, because that's important, we should know the lower rectum is difficult because to operate is because it has narrow mesorectum, proximity to sphincter complex, and difficulty in obtaining a negative surgical margin. Whereas higher rectal tumors have a thicker mesorectum, width of the pelvic inlet can be high, and generally has a favorable anatomy. The most difficult challenging will be anterior and lower rectal tumors because of the little anterior mesorectal fat. So these are the most difficult tumors to operate. Other things which are independent predictors for the positive resection margins are the tumors which are less than 4 centimeters from the anal verge, any tumor which are located anteriorly, tumors which have extramural venous invasion. They have a higher chance of positive resection margin. So this is a standard anti-resection, low anti-resection, upper or mid-rectal tumors. So the sphincters are preserved, so there's no colostomy. Intersphincteric resection is when the tumor is just involves the internal sphincter without invading into the intersphincter. So they can plan an intersphincteric resection with avoiding damaging the sphincters. Like in this case, probably on the right, you can see the tumor is only involving the internal sphincter, and there is a intersphincteric plane is probably preserved in this. That's the best example I could get. Whereas other surgical options, which are much more morbid, are not sphincter sparing, are the sphincters along with the tumor in the lower rectal tumor generally, or a much more morbid surgery with extra levator FIR when it is removed along with the levator and the muscles. So then is much a smaller or a limited surgical option is a transanal endoscopic microsurgery. They are selected patients of early rectal cancers which are well differentiated, generally T1, size less than 3 centimeters, generally small, 8 centimeters from the anal verge, less than 30% circumference involved. We can do an endoscopic surgery in these cases at some centers. Next, coming to the patients who cannot undergo upfront surgery, and these patients which are higher grades or higher stages will get a neoadjuvant chemoradiotherapy, because that improves the survival by downstaging the diseases and increasing the CRM negative resections, and they may enable sphincter preserving these sections. And MR, when we do after this new adjuvant CR chemo radiotherapy, is generally around 6 to 8 weeks after chemo RT to assess the response. The accuracy of MR, the assessment of the response is, it's a big topic itself, it's a huge talk in itself, but I'll try to cover in few slides. The accuracy of MR for restaging is generally lower compared, because what happens is we generally overstage this nodal disease. We cannot differentiate tumor infiltration from the residual tumor or desmoplastic reaction, radiation fibrosis, all these things are happening. And sometimes we misinterpret radiation properties as local invasion. So it is difficult. So how does a tumor respond to the chemoradiotherapy? Is it can fibrose or mucin or edema or inflammation, which will be T2 bright. So T2 dark, T2 bright. It can be spectrum of the signal, whereas residual signal is where it is of intermediate signal intensity.
So I say that one chapter was shayad abhi tak.
So
MR is time bolo.
I think let me mute. It's okay.
Dilki has a distinct
MRI has inability to detect this microscopic residual tumors. Yeah. So that's why it's not very accurate. And generally on images, a normalized two-layered wall is suggests a complete response. But again, it's very difficult to on MR. So we can see that this is a pre-CRT, pre-chemo RT, and post-chemo RT, the tumor has responded well, probably a minimal or mild intermediate signal, which is a tumor signal. Another case, we can see that this is on the left, is pre-chemo RT and post-chemo RT, the tumor has responded well. Mostly it is fibrosis, probably some intermediate signal, which is suggesting a residual tumor. There is a tumor regression scale, which is actually a pathological thing, but you can use it. There is equivalent to MR, which takes into account few things: presence of fibrosis, how much is fibrosis. The higher the fibrosis, the better it is, and whether we see a tumor signal. If you see the same tumor, then it's a TRG5, whereas you don't see a tumor at all, and mostly fibrosis is TRG1, and the lymph nodes are smaller. So you can give MR tumor regression scale post CRT as well. Then other role of MR is post-operative surveillance and follow-up. That's also important role of MR, because there is a risk of recurrence, which is depends on the pre-operative stage, histology, and how much tumor has been removed adequately or not. And the follow-up is generally by lab examination, the tumor markers, digital rectal examination, endoscopy, and of course, another thing is imaging, not only at looking at the local tumor recurrence, but also for distant metastasis. And we use again CT and MR for that. The evaluation of the nodes after post chemo radiotherapy can be difficult, because it's much more difficult than the primary nodal assessment. After chemo radiotherapy, the nodal size in the short axis is more reliable, because if the size gets reduced, it means it has responded well. So that's the simple thing. Whereas the reliable predictors of negative node status is, we look for diffusion weighted images in this thing. It's very important, because if this diffusion, which was bright, it's no longer diffusion bright, then definitely it is responded. Decrease in size and node which is less than 2.5 millimeter has responded well. Like in this case, this is a tumor with a node, abnormal signal here. Post chemo RT, you can see that there is hardly, we can see any node or just a dark signal here. So this is how a post-chemo RT node, which is seen. So what are the risk recurrence of rectal cancer? What are the risk factors? One is, when you do a surgery, it is positive CRM, no preoperative radiotherapy, venous invasion, perforation, close proximity to the anal verge. All these are factors which suggest that patient may have a recurrent tumor in later on follow-up. Again, any other tumor, sometimes it can be difficult whether how to differentiate recurrence from post-treatment change. But we can give contrast, and enhancement in the tumoral tissue has been shown to occur earlier and more intense compared to a benign post-treatment fibrosis. And if there's increase in the signal, abnormal signal or size of the abnormal signal, then invasive features, all these are which favor recurrence versus a post-treatment change. This is something which has come up recently is a non-surgical approach of managing rectal cancers in few selected patients for various reasons. It could be because patient has some other morbidities which make it difficult, or patient has responded so well and the surgeon may decide to watch and wait after chemo RT if there's a good response or very good response, or which is complete response, although we cannot really say that accurately on MR because microscopic disease we can't really see. But this is can be tried and has been being tried. It is a non-surgical approach, and follow-up is by clinical endoscopy as well as MR. And that MR plays a very important role because anything we compare and try to see if there is any change. A few cases, like miscellaneous cases, which we collected is some special cases of rectal cancers is in this case of polyposis, and there is a rectosigmoid tumor. So we should be aware of this. This is just to show some different signal. Sometimes tumors can be there. Anal canal adenocarcinomas can have along with abnormal signal in the teeth on this prostate. So the prostate cancers can be associated with, or they can be together. I mean, you can see them together. So look for them. Another case of rectal tumor, but again, outside exophytic, very benign looking, very well circumscribed. So this was a GIST, rectal GIST. Sometimes cases of anal fistula, like you can see there is this case of anal fistula, you can see there is abscess here, but can have a rectal tumor. So always when you see a case of fistula in on MR, so look for anything abnormal signal in the rectum. So we may be the first one to detect that. So that will be where maybe a role of MR in detection of rectal tumor. And this is another interesting case which came a few months back. This man was young. I think it was around 30 something man came with pain, and we could see there is on CT coronal, we can see there is abnormal rectal, there is rectal tumor, plus there is something else, which on MR looked it, them to be continuous. These are T2-weighted images. On T1, this was bright, this component was bright, and the whole tumor as well as this component was enhancing. But again, that was not a diagnosis which we made prospectively, but we raised as a possible in MDT discussion. This was a case of melanoma. Although I wanted to see if I could get a rectal metastasis or metastasis to the rectum, but I couldn't get. But this was something closest I could get in our collection, was this case of bladder CA who had a radical cystoprostatectomy, and this was November 2020 scan, which had we could see that we don't really see anything except for the bowel loops, and on a few months later there was something in the pelvis which was involving the rectum. Obviously it cannot be rectal cancer, cannot really spread or cannot grow so fast. So this was T2 axial and this was T2 sagittal, which was involving the rectum. So on, and this is how it looked on endoscopy, but on pathology it was a bladder cancer recurrence in the rectum. So template reporting is important. Again, there are lots of templates. I think you can see the literature, because why it is important, it promotes the consistent reporting, it increases the accuracy, helps to treatment decisions, and surgeons and clinicians generally like them because it's so easy to read and apply. There are various things which I think this is very well known, very old, what all things to look for on rectal cancer. So this is a mnemonic called distance, what to look for. And this is a good article, what we are looking, again, another mnemonic, what we should see, what are the steps to look in the MR, and how the things are there. This is what the whole, probably the talk in one single slide. And there are various treatment guidelines which are important. But one thing is sometimes the Europeans and Americans, there is slight difference. So the Europeans tend to divide tumors much more granular, and then they have a intermediate and signal which make some of these patients can get a short course radiotherapy as compared to Americans. Mostly they go for whole course of neoadjuvant chemoradiotherapy, and short course RT is also proven to be good and then patient can go for surgery with reduced rate of local recurrence. So various trials which are important, because compared to AGCC, which will just take into T3 or T4, MR plays a role to different prognostic criteria, prognostic characteristics we can assess on MR before we do surgery. And there are various trials and how they did after risk of local recurrence is low even with these trials, because they take into account of MR thing. Few controversies or limitations. What is CRM is generally circumferential resection margin is a post-operative margin. So imaging report, some people say that we should not be using this term on imaging because we should use the term mesorectal fascia. But CRM is not equal to mesorectal fascia in certain places like low rectal tumors, depending on the involvement of the sphincters, CRM is variable and can be intersphincter plane or APR. Or APR, so it is difficult. So that's one of the controversies. And MRIs generally overestimate CRM involvement due to inability to differentiate tumor from peritumoral fibrosis and inflammation. So it has a higher MR has a higher negative predictive value rather than positive predictive value. So if it's not involved, then we are very sure. When we see something, probably we are not sure whether it is fibrosis or tumor still. The same thing which I was talking, T2 versus early T3 can be difficult. Nodal assessment still difficult, but there are various guidelines. Even the guidelines say that this is just suggestions, but they may not be accurate. And MR generally is supposed to overestimate T stage in 27% and N stage in 44%. So we should be aware of that. And there are definitely recent advances like dynamic contrast enhancement, enhancement, detection analysis, the new lymph node we saw, PET CT to predict the survival and PET MR for better T staging. But again, they are not part of the standard guideline. So just last two slides. So what surgeons do not want or what no one wants, oncologists do not want is we don't want a local recurrence due to incomplete removal. So that's the key thing and whole exercise is towards that. Whole doing MR and imaging is we want to avoid the local recurrence and get a R0 resection. So this is the take home points of the today's lecture. Or what we have done is we have seen that MR helps in treatment triage of these unfortunate patients and MR helps in surgical planning, involvement of the mesorectal fascia, sphincter complex involvement, and that can help surgeons to plan the surgery. It also guides the surgeon in obtaining the negative resection margin and you can define the whole tumor, where is it, and they can plan the surgery. And other role of MR is response to treatment and detection of the recurrent disease. So that's what we have discussed and we have seen in this lecture. And thank you so much for your kind attention. It was my honor to be giving this lecture. Thank you again.
Thank you, Dr. Dinesh. That was a fantastic presentation. I really thank you very much for literally, you know, pouring into all your experience and telling us about how to approach the rectal cancer with MRI. I would request the audience to post their questions in the chat box, please. In the meantime, I have some queries to ask Dr. Dinesh.
Yes.
Do you use diffusion as a standard protocol or you don't use diffusion as a standard protocol?
We do diffusion. We do diffusion as standard, yes.
T2 fat sat, you use or you don't use?
We don't use routinely, but certain cases we do and it helps. Although some of, again, it depends on who consultants are there. Some of them do have a standard T2 fat sat also. I have seen it helps in certain number of cases. It does.
Okay. So as a routine, you still can do T2 fat set also. As a protocol, we can have T2 fat set also.
Yes, yes, yes.
Now, what I have seen in my experience is when we have difficulty in differentiating on T2 regarding the desmoplastic reaction versus tumor infiltration into mesorectal fat in T2/T3 tumors, diffusion MRI probably will help us a touch more in trying to show us those speculations which are more, have more diffusion restriction. Yes. So I am relying more on that nowadays because that is giving me an edge diffusion. So what is your experience on that?
I think it does help. But again, sometimes I have seen, and that again depends on the patient population also. We have a very high geriatric, or generally the patients are 90s, and sometimes when you get a good diffusion MR, definitely it does help. I mean, I totally agree, but not always it does.
Exactly.
And especially sometimes 3 Tesla can be, maybe 1.5 Tesla gives a better diffusion images rather than 3 Tesla when it's done.
Correct.
There.
Correct. So somehow I have been falling back on that particular thing, and somehow I could get that between T2, T3, and T3A. Somehow I could manage. Now the other thing you said was this contrast is not really useful. I mean, only except for the in those cases. But is there any way we can grade the tumor by doing K-trans perfusion parameters?
Yes. There are papers, although I'm not, because I have tried to put the guidelines, but there are dynamic contrast enhancement and perfusion analysis. Like it's becoming like almost like a multi-parametric thing.
Exactly.
But yes, there are lots of papers which they can grade. But having said that, but the standard guidelines do not really mention that. Yes, I agree.
Can we call them poor responders, good responders based on that? Are there any studies like that?
There are papers. There are certain stages, but I don't recall right now because what they use it for. But definitely they grade, and then they predict the tumor response after treatment. I agree that, but I don't.
They're not the routines. They're not standard line of
standard. Yes.
Investigation. They're only luxury items, not a necessity.
Yes. Yeah. Maybe as a research, or maybe as a part of a certain study or the trial, they may be doing. Yes.
One more important doubt I had was: do you routinely use screening of abdomen for liver metastasis, or only do this?
No, we do. Like the MR is only for the rectum, and then the patient invariably and probably on the same day in the same sitting gets a CT thorax abdomen pelvis
as a
staging disease.
Okay. There is one question here. Do you specifically mention presacral fascia involvement?
Yes.
This is from Dr. Rajgopal from Manipal. Mention presacral fascia involvement, MRF posterior in mid and upper rectal tumors. Rectal melanomas are not usually T1 bright. Any idea? And
yeah,
any particular role? Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
That was presacral fascia involvement we do mention. But yes, when it is there, definitely we do mention. It is there as one of the checklists. Everyone does that. Rectal melanomas, again, I don't have experience. That was one case which I picked up, and it had T1 bright. But again, we didn't really make any diagnosis upfront. That was what I was telling you. I was telling in the lecture. Intravenous contrast in determining local organ invasion. I think just doing T2 high, the small FOV, most of the times it answers the question, and we don't really do intravenous contrast. Intravenous contrast we do. For post CRT evaluation, but does it help in local organ invasion? It might, if there is a tumor which is like enhancing definitely into the organ. But if it answers the question without contrast, then probably we may not do it. Yeah.
Now I have one more doubt here. Any experience you have experienced in this superficial spreading cancer?
Superficial spreading.
These small plaque-like cancers, thin plaque-like cancers in the rectum.
Yes, sometimes the rectal cancers can. There is one case recently, but the patho report is not out yet. It could be. It almost looks like something which is growing in plaque. I mean, it was like inflammatory sort of response, but I didn't show. Yeah, but I have not seen many cases like this. Just one or two, maybe, if I can recall. But again, prospectively making a diagnosis was difficult. Yes.
Is there any difference between rectal cancer developing on ulcerative colitis versus regular non-ulcerative colitis presentation? Any difference in the cancer?
I don't have particular, because we don't have many cases, but I guess there should be a difference. And I mean, I don't have the literature. I mean, I've not read so far right now to answer this question.
Okay. Now, there is one more question. How to differentiate from rectal polyp in the initial stages?
No, I mean, just pathologically, just based on imaging on MR, I think we cannot differentiate whether it's a rectal polyp is malignant or how much it is dysplastic. We cannot really differentiate on MR, yes. Unless we see something invading, definitely that might suggest that this is a invasive cancer, yes.
Now, in your experience, how comfortable are you percent-wise? How comfortable? Or probably tell me all those instances where you feel like saying this is shit, I can't report this properly. Rectum is too tortuous. I mean, what are those things which you feel, you know, are negative for the radiologist?
Yes, one is definitely technical thing is if you've got a good scan, especially in elderly, sometimes it can be difficult to get a good scan. But the other thing is when the tumor has perforated, There is one very torturous thing. And then when you do axials, as I was telling, there are a lot of places where we really have to go all the three planes. And despite looking at all the three planes, we may not be really sure whether it is gone beyond and how much it has gone beyond. And in certain such cases, we all take this to the colorectal tumor board. And then we discuss. And sometimes when you are not sure, we tell the surgeons. And it's kind of a decision which is made with everyone around and everyone putting their heads together. Yes, it can be difficult in certain number of cases. But I should say that case number of those cases probably are maybe 10, 20% of the times rather than mostly 80, 90% of them. We make a fairly good decisions and accept that T2, how much it has T2 versus 3-3, but doesn't really matter when surgery, when they are totally taking it out.
Yes. One more question is there, how to differentiate from lower rectal cancer from squamous cell cancer?
No, that's again a histological diagnosis. So always when you do MR, always have a histological diagnosis before we do MR. Because sometimes, I think there are lots of incidents everyone has gone through. People have staged the disease and all, and eventually it has turned out to be benign. Because you have done MR, you have done T2, T3, everything. But so always have a pathological diagnosis. Or even there is no pathological diagnosis, mention that in the report that we are presuming this to be rectal cancer, and then based on that, the report is so and so. So don't do that mistake of reporting MR without a pathological diagnosis. And the next question, which I can see, is how to differentiate abscess on tumor on non-contrast MR, or even contrast MR for that matter. It can be very difficult. When the tumor which is abscess, then we may have to repeat the MR after the abscess is drained or they are treated, then we might make a better judgment.
There are some templates which mention as CRM clear, CRM involved. So are we using CRM or only MRF has to be used?
A mesorectal fascia involvement, that's what is, if that's the question. I think we still use it, whether it's threatened, involved, how far it has gone. And other thing is the advantage of is when we sit, generally, all these cases, the decisions are made in the tumor board. Then we go through the surgeons and show them where it is there. And the other thing, as even the current literature, it says there is one very nice article which is accepted in AJR, which is, I think, due to be published by Ms. Dr. Kaur and other group, is they say that is like important is to go by tumor rather than node or other things, which is much more reliable in the fascia rather than.
परत अनम्यूट केलं मी.
एनी अदर क्वेश्चन्स प्लीज.
डॉक्टर दिनेश, आय हॅव अ स्मॉल करेक्शन देअर. इन युअर वन स्लाइड यू हॅव प्रोजेक्टेड रिगार्डिंग एफडीजी पेट.
येस.
इट इज नॉट पेट सीटी, इट्स ओनली पेट. दॅट्स व्हाय यू हॅव told that the perilesional lymph nodes can be missed because